Welcome, everybody, to Westview Bible Church's online service. We are glad to have you here with us today. Hope you had a great 4th of July weekend. And just as we celebrate our country on that day, we celebrate our Lord. And today we're going to sing a song called Be Unto Your Name, which is really a praise to our Lord. So please join us in singing Be Unto Your Name.
Revelation chapter 5. I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a book written inside and on the back, sealed up with seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the book and to break its seals?" And no one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth was able to open the book or to look into it. Then I began to weep greatly because no one was found worthy to open the book or to look into it. And one of the elders said to me, "Stop weeping. Behold, the lion that is from the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has overcome so as to open the book and its seven seals." And I saw between the throne with the four living creatures and the elders, a lamb standing as if slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. And he came and took the book out of the right hand of him who sat on the throne. When he had taken the book, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each one holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, "Worthy are you to take the book and to break its seals, for you were slain and purchased for God with your blood men from every tribe and tongue and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests to our God, and they will reign upon the earth." Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne and the living creatures and the elders, and the number of them was myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." And every created thing which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and on the sea and all things in them, I heard saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and dominion forever and ever." And the four living creatures kept saying, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshiped. Amen. Amen. Let's sing Revelation song.
Sing. Our last song before the message is Ancient Words, and praise God for those ancient words. Amen. Let's join us in singing.
God, we just thank you so much for the wonderful opportunity we have to come here today to sing praises to your name and to look at those ancient words, dear Lord, the ones you set down 2,000 years ago and more, and that you bring to us every day. Lord, we pray that our, as the song says, our hearts and minds will be open to your spirit as he teaches us from those words. And we pray, dear Lord, that you'd bless Dean as he delivers that message, that people will hear the words, that it would go to their minds and hearts, and that it will get out into their lives. Lord, we praise you this day, and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hi, Westview and friends. It's good to be back. Thanks, George. So exciting to have Gail back and Yusef covering sound, and now everyone together for the first time since March. We trust that Brian will join us too. Keep him in your prayers as he fights through the migraines, and just pray for wisdom for his doctors. Wonderful time of praise. What a special gift they share to draw us closer to the presence of God and to help prepare our hearts for the word. So last week we took a little side trip. We were making our way through 1 Peter, and we came to see that we're biblically prohibited from having friendships with unsaved people. Now, if you know me, you know how particular I am about words when I'm communicating biblical truth. I know people think in terms of levels of friendships and different ways that they might consider someone and how they would describe their relationship of them, but I want to be clear biblically using the Bible's language and meaning, because words matter. I spend a good deal of my time preparing each week, making sure I understand from the Greek what the best translation is, and then accordingly what the best interpretation is, which of course has to be based on a good understanding of the English words considered by translators. These words don't always precisely align, and it might take a few more English words to get the idea across or a little more explanation, But in this case, that's only mildly necessary. The Greek word used for friend in our passages was philos, and it translates directly into the English word friend. And the Greek word used for friendship is philia, and it translates directly into the English word friendship. Nothing complicated, no nuances to consider. It's the same concept in both languages. As far as contextual interpretations of these words, we are instructed that our friends are not to be unsaved people or worldly Christians. And we should not extend friendship to worldly people, ways, possessions, influences, etc. And again, this is crystal clear in the various texts that we looked at last week. And remember, we looked at why God establishes this, and it begins with the nature of the unsaved. They have chosen a life of sin against God and have rejected, thus far, reconciliation through Christ. This makes them slaves to sin, to their flesh, and to Satan and his demons who currently shape the attitudes, the principles, the desires, the behavior, the speech, and every aspect of this world. That makes them in absolute opposition to God on every one of those fronts. So this is why James, when looking at the major problems in the church, including strife and passions and difficulties among even believers, attributes them to friendship with the world, which we learn makes us enemies of God. And we can only expect his opposition, he says, to our efforts if we find ourselves in that place. And remember, that came from that place of pride, from as described in James 4. Now, I get it. Maybe you've never heard this before. Maybe you've already crossed some of these lines. Or maybe you're a little put off by the teaching. Maybe you think it sounds extreme or unkind. But I want to assure you that nothing could be further from the case. Before Christ came, this was a very stark reality. The Israelites were to reject outsiders. They were often used by God to judge them by utterly annihilating them. Unless someone outside came to them in faith to join them, then in that case they were to be treated the same as every other Jewish believer. Since Jesus has come and now opened the message of salvation to the entire world because the Jews rejected him, now we're in this age of grace which has come upon us, and it does change the believer's role in the unbeliever's life. It is not to judge, that's left to the Lord. It is not to reject, that's reserved for their final judgment. They may come to him even on their deathbed, and if they do in sincere faith, they will be in heaven. And it's not to reprimand, for they can't help but sin. They are enslaved to it, just as we were or would be without Christ. And unlike Israel, we are not commanded to have nothing to do with them. We are instead commanded to indeed try to reach them with the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is our one and only God-approved motivation behind every interaction we have with people who are not saved. We may or may not be given a door of opportunity to share Christ, but we can always make it clear we're Christians and then live out holy lives in a hostile world as an example. God will use our behavior often in a lost person's journey to faith. So will Satan. So Paul warns us to be wise. Peter urges us to live holy, different lives. James warns us not to have friendship with the world. And Paul further informs us that there is no basis at all for us to have unsaved friends or any other type of sharing relationship with unbelievers, because there's no basis for such sharing. In fact, just the opposite. This is the concept of believers being in the world, but not of the world. You may think that Jesus was friends with sinners, but we again need to be very biblical in our language. Jesus explained his relationships with great clarity. The lost were the sick, the sinners, those in need of healing and redemption. He never called any of them friends, and that's a good thing, because he also gave some clear definitions of what a friend is, and they could never meet them. Remember, he said, "You are my friends if you keep my commandments." And greater love hath no one than this, and he lay down his life for his friends. And then he said to the disciples, "I no longer call you slaves, but I have called you friends, because slaves do not know the business of the master, but I have revealed all things to you." I think some of the confusion occurs because the Pharisees accused Jesus of being the friend of tax collectors and sinners. That is in the scriptures. Jesus, however, never referred to himself this way. His relationship to sinners was to offer them healing, to offer them salvation, to offer them redemption. Remember, he continually said to them, come to me, and if they would come to him, they would be saved. Now, if they did, they became his friends, and he theirs. If not, you could never describe their destiny as being one of friendship with Christ. But he didn't reject them. He did have proximity to them, all for the simple reason of presenting them with the gospel of himself. If they reject him, he rejects them. And he was nice to them, not mean or cruel. And by nice, I mean he was truthful, and he desired for them to accept him as their Messiah unto salvation. Now that said, we are also living on the same earth, and actually living more in their world than our own now. We have a new country. We await our new earth. We have our own king now. But we also reside on this earth with them, only now as aliens and strangers, remember? And therefore, we must have interactions that may not involve an opportunity to share Christ, or even much of an opportunity to show Christ. Those encounters are simply to be transactional. We shop, so we interact at some level with the workers in the store. We dine out, again, some interaction of the workers in the restaurant. There's governments that we have to interact with at times, and those that work with them we have to interact with at times. We are out and about, and we cross paths with others who are no doubt not saved, with no connection beyond simple proximity on the road or along our way as we're doing our life. We are commanded not to want more, not to pursue more, not to not like or love their world or love them, with the exception of wanting them to be saved. Not to want what they have, whether lifestyle, possessions, personality, status, nothing about them. So where does that leave us? Well, we're supposed to reach unbelievers for Christ in two ways. One, by our pure and godly behavior around them, which is meant to purposefully be in great contrast to how they live their lives. This is that idea of being a light in the world. And so how we speak should be much different. How we interact with people should be much different. How we think, what our attitudes are, all these things should be clearly much different than the world's. And second, if we're given the opportunity to share Christ with them. As we maintain separation from the world, but not isolation from the world, and we stay alert for opportunities, however small, and we live wholly separate lives that honor Christ and stand in opposition and contrast to the lives of the unsaved around us, and as we do this, then God can open up opportunities for us to reach others for Christ. And so how then should we interact with them? I think that's the question that a couple of you brought up. And the Holy Spirit has made it clear it must be with wisdom. It's got to be with wisdom because they cannot be trusted. That's why they need to hear the gospel message. They need to hear it from wise, cautious, shrewd, but also innocent, holy people. So so it's going to take some considerable wisdom. Wisdom which is readily available in the scriptures, wisdom which is instilled in the lives of many mature believers, and the one who has perfect wisdom is always ready to give it to us when we don't know and we ask. And so we have a lot of places to go to get the wisdom that we need when we're not sure, but we're going to need to do it. Jesus warned the disciples when he sent them out with his message while they were on earth, to be as shrewd as serpents and as innocent as lambs. So we're going to constantly be looking at the breadth of possibilities with very clear parameters within which we must always work in our interrelationships with people who don't know Christ, meaning that somewhere between nothing at all beyond transactional interaction and a somewhat comprehensive potential opportunity to share the gospel. In wisdom, you may not be the best messenger. You may be the worst, in fact. And ladies, I'm just going to just say, when it comes to unsaved men in your lives, this may often be the case. If you think there may be some kind of opening with an unsaved guy in your life, then I encourage you to find out by trying to bring them with you. You can come with them into contact with a believing guy that you know who can share Christ with them. Maybe your husband, for instance, or a family member, or someone from church that you know is strong in the gospel, or a leader in the church, the pastor, or one of the other elders. If they will only engage with you, probably time to move on. Here's why this is wise. The first thing you have to know about every single unbeliever, and this, yes, I'm talking to the ladies still, but listen, this is for everyone, is that you can only trust one thing about them, and that is that they are not in any way obedient to God. They are actively disobedient to him, and therefore they cannot be trusted. Beyond this, even if they behave with a certain code of honor that might seem a little bit like the life of holiness that we're called to, they are not motivated for any good reason, meaning especially the glory of God. It does not change anything about how we should interact, nor should we trust that. Now, when you know you have an open door, then you need two things. You need a lifestyle that supports your message, the ability to clearly communicate that message, so that a prepared heart and mind are ready to give a defense of the message of the gospel. Whatever they may throw at you, you're ready to help them sort it out. And all this must be done in a gracious way, and not just gracious, but he says that your speech should be seasoned with grace and salt. Grace in this context speaks of being courteous, of being civil and polite, but also with salt. And so this brings the idea of a more confrontive way, in a eye-catching way, in a challenging way, so that they will understand the peril and the destiny of those who reject Christ, all the while conducting yourself with wisdom so you do not in any way get caught up in their ungodly behavior or get pulled in by them into a compromised situation of any kind that would impede the message or even worse by your behavior, your reputation, and testimony. Keep your behavior pure and holy and righteous, being like Christ. Now, part of why I said ladies especially is because of the nature of sin. There's over 15 different ways that sexual sins are addressed in the scriptures. And many of them, most of them, occur when men are being aggressive or predatory in the pursuit or treatment of women. Sin has hardwired this desire in men, and girls and ladies, don't be naive. Many of them will do or say anything that they think will open up that possibility. Don't fall for flattery. Don't get caught up in their troubles that they share to get you to sympathize with them. Don't fall for their tales of woe that they share so that you'll want to save them in a human way. Watch for the men's Me Too movement, whereby they magically think and like or feel the exact same way as you do about almost everything. Watch out, and honestly, if you simply refuse to let yourself become friends with them, you're not going to need to worry about this. Maintaining that clear line, staying in either a purely transactional relationship, whether at work or in daily life, or if the opportunity arises, to share the gospel. And men, it's starting to shift. Many women are becoming equally aggressive about such things. And I'll tell you what, if you add alcohol to the mix, or certain maybe late night situations, there's a number of things where kind of all bets are off, and men and women are all capable of the same thing. Listen, this is something we all have. We're saved, and saved people struggle with these things too. Imagine for those who don't have any reason not to control themselves. And in any case, we all need wisdom. And this is literally only one aspect of sin. The unregenerate are powerless against the sway of sin, and in every way are not just capable of it, but inherently wired to do it. And keep in mind, the regenerate are still capable of it as well. And we're warned also to not hang around Christians who are undisciplined or ungodly, or in some way are not seriously pursuing the Lord. They should not be in our circle of friends, and we shouldn't be associating with them. Paul said, don't even share a meal with them. So I hope you see that there are really clear reasons. All of these types of people are going to bring you down. You're not going to bring them up to greater devotion to God. They're going to bring you down to a lesser devotion to God. And your behavior, your attitudes, your speech will be compromised, and you will live much more by the flesh and much less by the Spirit. So I hope that brings a little clarity to what I was talking about last week and helps equip you for those in your life who are unsaved and how to behave around and interact with them, to speak with them, and the same for any who claim Christ, but they're clearly not that into following him. And a little tip to spot that, just watch their lifestyle, how they spend their money. What do they talk about the most? What do they get excited about? It's not hard to tell, folks. And let's all make sure that we ourselves don't become so-called believers. Let's nurture our relationship with God and never let up and be lights shining brightly for Jesus, so that when we have the opportunity to speak, the message is aligned with a sincere life of following Christ. So to kind of that wraps that up, and I want to pick back up with where we were at the end of that last message. We talked also about laying out the Old Testament references that Peter brought up in chapter 2, verses 4 through 8. And by started, I mean we did one. So remember, we talked about being living stones in verse 4 of chapter 2. Peter said, "And coming to him as a living stone, which has been rejected by men, but is choice and precious in the sight of God, you also as living stones are being built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For this is contained in Scripture, 'Behold, I lay in Zion a choice stone, a precious cornerstone, and he who believes in him will not be disappointed.' This precious value then is for you who believe, but for those who disbelieve, the stone which the builders rejected became the very cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. For they stumble because they are disobedient to the word, and to this doom they were also appointed. This amazing truth that we're being built up into a spiritual building, which turns out to be the temple, not a physical temple any longer, but now the union of the saints made priests in Christ, who is the head, who is the body of which we are all members, and the high priest in this priesthood. And through him, we now do what we've been called to do in service, to bring honor and glory to Christ, to his name, and to be acceptable to God, because it's according to his will." What a promise, what a fact. He who believes in him will never be disappointed. What a perfect statement of assurance. Never be disappointed, ever. That means once a person comes to Christ, every single promise he's ever made to them absolutely will be fulfilled. God has positioned us better than Israel, better than the chosen Jews. But he says, "You also are a chosen race, not based on physical attributes, but on a single spiritual attribute, faith. Israel is a chosen race, a chosen people, but so are you, in a substantially greater sense, too. Israel had a priesthood, one household, Aaron's, and one tribe, Levi's, and they served as priests, but all of us who believe are part of a royal priesthood. Every one of us. And they were a nation set apart for God. You are too, and a people for God's own possession. They had a purpose to show the greatness and faithfulness of God, and so do we, to show the mercy and grace and salvation of God, and to be living testaments to his excellencies. They are the people of God. You weren't, but now you are. We who believe, we become the very people of God because now we have received mercy." And it leaves us in a place that we're in no way inferior to the Jews. We're blessed in ways that even they aren't. And you have the greatest calling of all to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. So in Deuteronomy 7, 6 through 11, this is where this idea of a holy people comes from. This is when God is talking to the people through Moses. He says, "For you're a holy people to the Lord your God. The Lord God has chosen you to be a people for his own possession out of all the peoples who are on the face of the earth. The Lord did not have set his love on you nor choose you because you were more in number than any of the peoples, for you were the fewest of all the peoples. But because the Lord loved you and kept the oath which he swore to your forefathers, the Lord brought you out by a mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of slavery, from the hand of Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. Know therefore that the Lord your God, he is God, the faithful God, who keeps his covenant and his loving kindness to a thousandth generation with those who love him and keep his commandments, but repays those who hate him to their faces to destroy them. He will not delay with him who hates him. He will repay him to his face. Therefore, you shall keep the commandment and the statutes and the judgments which I am commanding you today to do them. So God, choosing through his promises to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who became Israel, and he tells them that he's going to faithfully keep his promises. He's going to keep his covenant with them. He's going to show his loving kindness to those that love him. Don't hate God, he says, you'll be judged, but be reconciled to God. And now the message is through Christ, his son. Be reconciled to God through the sacrifice of Christ and be forever blessed beyond all imagination. What an amazing contrast for them and now us to grasp, as we are rejected by this world on so many levels. But now we are the chosen people of God. He has handpicked us before anything was created to belong to him. We were created for this purpose. And we were chosen in him for eternal life in his son, in Christ Jesus, whom we would have otherwise rejected. But because of the choice of God, because of the mercy of God, we are chosen from darkness, each one doing what was right in our own eyes, to become a chosen people, into a unity that relates us all, it makes us a chosen race. And our Father, the same as the physical Israel's father, the same as the father of the many nations, Abraham. And the seed through which we were brought to be was faith. We are Abraham's spiritual descendants. But that's not all. We're also a royal priesthood. And so we are a priesthood. First of all, Israel had a priesthood. That was established with Aaron and his sons and their descendants. Exodus chapter 40, verses 13 through 16, Moses was commanded, "You shall put the holy garments on Aaron and anoint him and consecrate him that he may minister as a priest to me. You shall bring his sons and put tunics on them, and you shall anoint them, even as you have anointed their father, that they may minister as priests to me, and their anointing will qualify them for a perpetual priesthood throughout their generations." Thus Moses did, according to all the Lord commanded him, so he did it. So we have this Aaronic priesthood, but it wasn't a royal priesthood. Aaron wasn't royalty. There has only ever been one royal priesthood, and that comes out of Genesis chapter 14, verses 18 through 20, and it says this, "And Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine," and ironically, this was actually to meet Abraham. "Now, he was a priest of God Most High, and he blessed him and said, 'Blessed be Abram of God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth, and blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hand.'" Now listen, as great a man as Melchizedek was, Jesus is immeasurably greater, being established as a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek, qualified by virtue of an indestructible life. Hebrews 5, 5 and 6 says this, "So also Christ did not glorify himself so as to become a high priest, but he who said to him, 'You are my son, today I've begotten you,' just as he says in another passage, 'You are a priest forever,' according to the order of Melchizedek." And in Hebrews 9, 11 and 12 it says this, "But when Christ appeared as high priest of the good things to come, he entered through the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands," that is to say, not of this creation, "and not through the blood of goats and calves, but through his own blood. He entered the holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption." And like Melchizedek, Jesus is a king, but an immeasurably greater king. Look at 1 Timothy 6, verses 11 through 16. Paul speaking to Timothy, his son in the faith, he tells him, "But flee from these things, you man of God, and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, perseverance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called, and you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who testified the good confession before Pontius Pilate, that you keep the commandment without stain or reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will bring about at the proper time. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone possesses immortality, and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. King of kings, the only sovereign, who alone possesses immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen or can see, to him be honor and eternal dominion. This is the ultimate king, and it's Jesus Christ. Revelation 19:16 says this, and on his robe and on his thigh he has a name written, King of kings and Lord of lords. So the great Melchizedek, a royal priest, but Jesus, an immensely greater royal high priest, and by association, we shall reign and serve alongside him. What an amazing reality. The world looks down on us like we're the weak fools. We were once like them, remember, so we got to be careful. But now imagine being elevated from being mockers and haters to becoming part of this royal priesthood to God Almighty, and called to offer sacrifices that are acceptable to him and to him alone. What an honor. God lifts us up from the mire of our sins and sets us before himself to serve and honor him. People, praise him. We are not worthy. It is only through Christ. And you know what? That's not all. We are also now a holy nation, a people for God's own possession. And this refers to Exodus 19, 1 through 6 for the Jews. It says, in the third month after the sons of Israel had gone out of the land of Egypt, on that very day they came into the wilderness of Sinai. When they set out from the Rephidim, they came to the wilderness of Sinai and camped in the wilderness, and there Israel camped in front of the mountain. Moses went up to God, and the Lord called him from the mountain, saying, thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the sons of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now then, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be my own possession among all the peoples, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words you shall speak to the sons of Israel. A kingdom of priests, referring to the Levitical Aaronic priesthood, and a holy nation, referring to all who through faith follow and obey him, God's own possession. And they did, and then they didn't, remember? And then they did again, and then they didn't again, over and over again, until he said enough. And he has them on hold right now. He brought Messiah, and that signaled the pause in God's dealings with Israel because they rejected him. Now they, like anyone, can come to Jesus today by hearing the gospel and believing in it. But when this time of grace is completed and the final one that's meant to be saved is saved, it's going to usher in the final chapter in the great history of Israel, and they shall have their Messiah, King, Priest, Jesus Christ, reign over the world for 1,000 years. All of God's promises to Israel will be kept. And us, why are we made into this nation, into God's own possession? Well, he actually tells us right in this passage, starting in verse 9. He says, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. For once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. You had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. We are made into this nation for the simple purpose of proclaiming the excellencies of him who has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. It is so that we can share the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is our purpose, folks, which is why it's so important that we live right. We are the light of this world. What a story we have to tell, amen? Your story of how God redeemed you, my story of how God redeemed me. We are perfectly equipped to proclaim his excellencies, the many things that he does for those who come to him. And listen, that's not all. Listen to this. We were once not a people. That was all the way up until the moment before we believed, before we received faith. But now we are not just a people. Now we are the people of God. And in that exact same way, we had not received mercy. But now we have received mercy. Mercy we didn't think we needed right up until the very moment before we believed, before we received faith. But then we did, and we knew the mercy of God. We don't deserve it. What can the world do to us? Nothing of consequence. What reason would prevent us from shouting the excellencies of God, proclaiming boldly the message of salvation in Christ, to tell each one we're given the opportunity to? Come to Jesus and live and thrive. God has taken all the blessings he poured upon Israel and magnified them and made them even better through Jesus. And now we are so blessed. We have the truth that the world desperately needs, the only true answers to life's only important question, how must I be saved? And the assurance that sets a person free, free to obey, free to proclaim Christ, free to honor him, to truly worship the only true God, eternal life in Jesus Christ. Unfortunately, the only real weakness we have is indeed we ourselves. 1 Peter 2:11 and 12 says this, "Beloved, I urge you as aliens and strangers to abstain from the fleshly lusts which wage war against the soul. Keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles, so that in the thing in which they slander you as evildoers, they may, because of your good deeds, as they observe them, glorify God in the day of visitation." We give into those fleshly lusts, our own fleshly lusts, and it's not just sexual lusts. It's every evil kind of lust for the things of this world. And we don't abstain from them, and it diminishes our capacity. It diminishes our willingness, our effectiveness in sharing the gospel. So Peter encourages, exhorts, entreats us to abstain from them and to keep our behavior excellent among the Gentiles, meaning unbelievers. Control your impulses, control your mouth, control your temper, control your behavior, control your thoughts, control your heart. How? By walking in the Spirit instead of the flesh. How? By the Word of God, by humbling yourself before God, and by yielding to God each moment. What's at stake? Your testimony of Jesus. How? Well, by remembering what he's done for you. So what do we do? Well, we need to choose our friends wisely. We need to keep ourselves unstained by the world. We need to position ourselves to grow in Christ. We need to live holy lives in the midst of a hostile world. We need to show Jesus by living in careful obedience to Jesus. We need to share Jesus by being ready to respond whenever we're given an opportunity. We need to not hide our light. Let people know that we're Christians, that we follow Jesus. And we need to protect ourselves from bad influences of those who don't know Jesus and from those who claim to, or maybe really are, but they don't follow him closely. We need to help our kids in life by setting a good example, teaching them the principles of the Word, and interceding when their choices warrant it. So the question is this, it's a simple question. How are you doing with these things? Take an honest look at yourself before the Lord, and then determine to make whatever changes you need to make to get yourself in alignment, and then be used by God to make a difference in this world. You have no idea how he may use you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for your word and for the truth of it, and even some of the truths are a little harder to process or a little harder to accept. And Lord, we just humble ourselves and say, well, whatever your word says, whether it's hard or whether it's easier for us, help us to do it. Help us to embrace it and help us to exemplify whatever it is that you call us to. Lord, may we live our lives in a way that we would never be the reason that someone would hesitate or slow down in coming to Christ because they're trying to make sense of it all in accordance with our lives. Instead, Lord, may we be that light that just clearly points the way, and they can say, amen, that does make a difference. And if they're among your chosen, Lord, that they could just come to you with ease and glorify you. Father, we're grateful for your love for us, your mercy for us. We're grateful that you've chosen us, made us a holy nation, turned us into a priesthood, a royal priesthood. Imagine royalty, us, royalty in the line of Christ. We don't deserve it. What an amazing blessing it is. We have so many excellencies to tell the world about, but but it seems like of late it's just not getting out. Lord, help us to help break that cycle. Use us, Lord. Use us to step up, to be bold, to not be afraid, to take that risk, to even though maybe we've had a slow start, maybe we've even had a negative start, to turn it around or to kick it off and start living this way for Christ amongst those that you've brought into our lives that don't know you. So, Father, we commit ourselves to you to that end, and we pray for your whole church in the same way. In Jesus' name, amen. Westview, good to see you again, sort of. Well, you see me. Good for you to see me again. I'll see you next week.
Thank you for joining us for our online service today, and thank you, Pastor Dean, for the message from God's Word. We're grateful for the power and impact it is in our lives, and we're grateful for you, the community of believers, being there to worship with us. And we're going to close out our service with Come Ye Sinners, Poor and Needy. I just wanted to read the first verse of this song. It's really powerful. It says, "Come ye sinners, poor and needy, weak and wounded, sick and sore. Jesus ready stands to save you, full of pity, love, and power." Please join us.